Hello again. Welcome to Actility's LoRaWAN Frontline webinar series, episode number 3. The topic of today is LoRaWAN network collaboration, also known as roaming. My name is Alper Yegin. I'm the VP of Advanced Technology Development in Actility and also the chair of the technical committee and the vice chair of the board in the LoRa Alliance. This webinar is recorded and we will be sharing the recording along with the slides after the webinar to the participants and people who had registered. There's also a Q&A session at the end. Now the Q&A is open. You can start typing your questions and we will get to it after the last speaker. I would like to first describe the autonomy we have with the LoRaWAN deployments. There are two fundamental features we have with LoRaWAN. One is the ability to build very low-cost infrastructure. The second one is the use of unlicensed band. Thanks to the combination of these two features, we have been witnessing organic growth in multiple fronts. So we see LoRaWAN networks being built in the residences, at homes of people, individuals, and then LoRaWAN networks covering commercial buildings like hospitals, office buildings, manufacturing sites. And then we see people building LoRaWAN networks across campuses like universities, larger construction sites, and cities are covered by LoRaWAN, and even countries such as France, Switzerland, Netherlands, Belgium, Finland, and Thailand, nationwide coverage. And finally, we see companies putting LoRaWAN gateways on low Earth orbiting satellites to provide planet-wide coverage. These two features, propelling the organic growth, has provided autonomous networks coming up all across the world. Now, while we have this autonomous deployments, which are independent of each other and coming all around the world, we've been also able to provide unification across these networks, because at the end of the day, when the users want to enjoy the coverage, they not only want to enjoy the coverage provided by one network, but they like to leverage coverage provided by several networks. So that's where the LoRaWAN roaming comes into the picture. And on that front too, we have a very unique position because we've been enjoying a very collaborative ecosystem thanks to the LoRa Alliance, building and nurturing this ecosystem. And our technology is also collaborative, and I will dive into that in the next couple of slides. And we have a very simple and scalable backend standard that's been instrumental in stitching together networks of all types and sizes across the board. So on the technology side, we have a collaborative radio. It's a feature also called macro diversity. So here's how it works. When a LoRaWAN end device transmits a packet or an uplink frame, that frame gets received and demodulated by any one of the LoRaWAN gateways within the coverage. So in this case, you see there are three LoRaWAN gateways and they can all individually receive the uplink frame and push it towards a core network. And then where the frames get reduced to single copy and then pushed to the application server. Whereas if you look at the other wireless communication technologies like Narrowband IoT, LTE-M, 5G and Wi-Fi, we see a connection-oriented design, which means the end device, after doing a network discovery and selection, it picks a base station and attached to that. And after that point on, even if there might be multiple other base stations within the coverage, they won't be serving the device at all. So their presence would be irrelevant and they'll be useless. And only single base station would be effectively providing connectivity. Now, the benefit of what you see on the left-hand side is much better resiliency in the face of changing RF conditions due to mobility of the end device or due to obstacles moving in and out of the coverage, like a big truck pulling in front of the sensor, and also the changing availability of the network infrastructure. Now, when we ensure, even if a single gateway were to receive that uplink frame, that's good enough. And in many times, multiple gateways do receive that frame, and that provides a much better reception in terms of reducing the frame loss and reducing the packet error rate. And then we take full advantage of this micro diversity, not only for simple network access, but even for roaming. So in the LoRa Alliance, we have built the so-called LoRaWAN passive roaming, which you can also call a transparent roaming, because the end device does not involve in the signaling. and it can transparently go in and out of roaming. As I have shown you in the previous slide, thanks to microdiversity, multiple gateways being able to serve the end device. These gateways can belong to distinct networks. So that means the end device could be served by one or more foreign networks and even the home network all at the same time. The net effect of doing that is basically unification of the radio access resources to provide a densified access network towards the end device. And thanks to the LoRaWAN's adaptive data rate feature, now this end device can reduce its transmission power and increase its transmission data rate, which in turn lets the device preserve battery. And it reduces the interference over the air, which helps to increase the network capacity. And by multiple LoRaWAN gateways receiving the same frame, thanks to the fine time stamping, we can provide even more enhanced geolocation feature. We've been fully leveraging all these features, and at the end, now we're able to provide various flavors of roaming or network collaboration to the end users. In terms of the relative coverage types, obviously, we support the traditional international complementary coverage where there are nationwide networks and they can add their coverage with each other through roaming. That's the most common case that we're familiar from other technologies. And then in case two, you see here, there are two networks with partial nationwide coverage, but through roaming, they're able to provide nationwide coverage towards their users. And in case three, you see there are two overlapping networks and they can complement each other, densify each other's network through passive roaming. And we also engage not only the terrestrial networks, but also the satellite networks. And the satellite networks provide coverage in the most remote areas within the country and beyond the country borders for public operators and also private networks as well. And all of these combinations are made available to any one of the public networks, private networks, and the community networks. So you will see in this webinar, we have concrete examples of all combinations that our networks have set up roaming among them. And irrespective of the network type and the size, we're able to stitch networks together towards providing enhanced service to their customers. And as we have all these facilities, the next challenge we have faced was how to interconnect an ever-growing list of networks, because interconnecting them would naturally create a mesh interconnect. And quickly, we have seen that setting up such interconnect and maintaining such interconnect would not be cost-effective and trivial. And that's why we have also adopted a well-known concept of building peering hubs. Peering hub turns that mesh interconnect into star topology, which makes the interconnection much more scalable, low cost, and manageable. ThingPark Exchange is the peering hub that we have built. It's the very first peering hub built and operated in the LoRaWAN market. And it's based on the LoRaWAN standard. As such, it is compatible with any network server and joint server that's compliant with the standard backend interface spec. It's been serving public and private and community networks, including both terrestrial and satellite ones, and not only for roaming, but also for activation. And we have been already adding network servers and joint servers built and maintained by third parties outside Actility to this platform. And it is a global service. And using this peering hub, we have built the very first LPWAN backbone that's been serving numerous networks. At the bottom, you see the terrestrial public networks. You see networks from Europe, Americas, and Asia, and APAC. And at the top, you see the satellite networks we have connected, and the enterprise and private networks as well, and the community networks. And now we are even onboarding the academic networks to the backbone. And on the activation side, we have two infrastructure providers connected to this backbone. And in today's webinar, we have guests from various companies who will be illustrating different use cases. So Ari from Digita will talk about how they have built a nationwide network in Finland and how they have been using roaming in public-to-public setup with other public operators. in order to provide multi-country solution for the multinational solution providers they have been serving. Then we will hear Maxime from Schneider talk about how their multinational solution provider has built a core network of its own, a private network, and they have been setting up roaming with the public networks in order to leverage the nationwide coverage in multiple countries without having to make an CapEx investment in those countries. Next, Nicolas will take us to the top of the Alps, where he will show us how they've been building LoRaWAN networks in the extreme geographic areas where no one else would be able to build such networks. And the EPIC private network has been made available to another private network through roaming, where the latter private network would never have a chance to go and build such radio network in such extreme conditions. And then Mark from Helium will tell us more about the largest and the fastest growing community network they have been building and how the coverage provided by Helium Network has been made available to the other networks through this backbone. And finally, Claire from Kinéis will take us to the space, will show us how they've been putting gateways on the LEO satellites, and the satellite network they have been building is made available to the LoRaWAN networks through this backbone. So with that, now I would like to turn the floor over to Ari.
Thank you, Alper. My name is Ari Kukka. I'm from a company Digita operating in Finland, and I will spend the next few minutes to go through how we see LoRaWAN roaming will be helping our customers growing their own businesses in the future. I'll start with a short intro on our company, and then we look at a few real-life use cases from our customer base who are interested in roaming or even using it already today. We look at how we see roaming is important for our customers to help them grow and succeed in own businesses. And on the other hand, how I see roaming is important for LoRaWAN community, the operators, to help the LoRaWAN as a technology grow and succeed. And then we'll end the presentation with the kind of a summarize on how I see a great LoRaWAN roaming experience, how that is built. Digita is a company who's been around for a long time. We are around 95 years old organization. Our traditional main business has been a TV and radio broadcasting, which is still today our backbone. But today we have several other digital infrastructure services we are providing to our customers. We are an IoT network operator with a nationwide network here in Finland. We also provide our customers with private 5G networks, telecom site services, data center services. We are around 200 people here in Finland. Today, Digita is owned by a Digital Bridge Group, who is one of the world's largest digital infrastructure investment companies. I'm heading the IoT business unit, and like I said, the LoRaWAN IoT network is our core offering to our IoT customers. Let's look at a few real-life LoRaWAN roaming use cases where our customers either are planning to or even today already using LoRa in their own business. I'm not having the real customer names here, but these are all real cases. So there's a multinational wood products manufacturer who are operating pretty much globally. They have their own production facilities in several countries, and they have a fairly large amount of end customer sites in multiple countries. And they are looking to deploy LoRaWAN-based solutions on those, both their own facilities and on the end customer sites. Another example, there's an IoT solution provider who is providing LoRaWAN-based services or solutions to construction industry. And they are now looking to expand their sales from Finland to the other European countries and looking to keep using LoRa also in the other countries. Another example, there's a Finnish company specializing in indoor air quality monitoring services. And they are bidding for large multinational real estate projects where the buildings to be monitored are located in several countries. Another example, there's an industrial equipment vendor who also have end customers around the world, and they are looking to develop add-on solution for their own products utilizing LoRaWAN, and the solution would be deployed to this vendor's own end customer facilities. Last example, there's an environmental services company who are operating in the Scandinavian markets, and they are looking to deploy an in-house LoRaWAN solution to optimize the efficiency of their own business process. So what all these customers are interested in and require in many cases is an easy-to-use, cost-efficient roaming solution to help them concentrate on their own businesses. Let's look a bit more detailed on how we see that roaming helps our customers to grow and to succeed. If we look at the LoRaWAN use cases or the IoT use cases today, the footprint of the solution deployments is certainly growing. Today, we have more and more bigger enterprises, multinational enterprises, who are looking to use LoRa in their own solutions. And with that, they are requiring not just a nationwide network solution, but let's say EU-wide or even global. There's these solution providers who are looking to expand their own solution sales to other markets, and with that, looking for LoRaWAN connectivity in those new markets. Obviously, logistics, goods traveling between countries, that's a classical roaming use case, relevant for LoRa as well. And something maybe bit more for the future, but I see consumer IoT solutions becoming a big IoT use case in the future, and the mobile people traveling between countries will be requiring roaming also for LoRaWAN. So why do all these different types of customers, why do they want to use roaming and not just deal directly with operators in various countries? I think one of the biggest reasons is that with roaming, we are able to bring simplicity to these customers. And simplicity often translates to business advantage. Through roaming, our customers are able to avoid having multiple integrations, multiple management platforms in their own solutions. Through roaming, we should be able to provide customers better predictability in the commercial aspects like SLAs, pricing, to help them concentrate building their own business solutions for their multinational markets. On the mobile use cases, LoRaWAN as a technology fits very well most of the mobile use cases, like asset tracking. And I think there's a great opportunity to expand these LoRaWAN benefits for these type of use cases also through roaming to provide our customers with larger footprint, for example, for asset tracking in logistics. Then let's look at from another point of view, why do I see roaming is important for the LoRaWAN ecosystems, the operators and solution providers? I think that the customer landscape has been changing during the last years, and it's kind of maturing. In the early days, I think a typical customer used to be maybe a bit smaller company, kind of IoT pioneer, and often the market was the home country, the kind of nationwide coverage was the thing they were looking for. But today, we are seeing more and more customers from larger enterprises, multinational enterprises, who are naturally looking to deploy solutions in all of their operating markets, and they are looking to use uniform technology in all of those markets. So we are seeing growing need from regional or nationwide footprint to be able to provide our customers with EU-wide footprint or even global footprint in some cases. I think none of the competing technologies really solve this kind of challenge today for the low power wide area vertical. And due to this, I think there's a great opportunity for LoRaWAN to take this leading position and help define how will this kind of multinational low power wide area connectivity solve our customer needs in the future. Last few points on how I see LoRaWAN. What is a great roaming user experience for our end customers? For us operators, all these APIs, the technology behind the bonnet is important. But what I think is more relevant and more important for our customers is a bit different kind of points of view. Things like network coverage, service levels, when going from a country to another, customers are looking for predictability and a uniform customer experience between all their markets. Pricing is another factor where good roaming experience is able to provide our customers with predictability. So when they sell solution to their own end customer in various markets, they should be able to predict and see how the pricing behaves. There's very different use cases from one message per day to hundreds. There's a mobile roaming between countries, permanent stationary roaming use cases. And in all of these cases, customers should be able to predict how can they build their own business on top of roaming. And I think if we succeed in this LoRaWAN roaming, we'll be able to take away all these complexities from our end customers and let them concentrate to build their own business, which is then a great success for both our customers and us, the LoRaWAN ecosystem. I thank you. And next, I will give the floor to Maxine from Schneider Electric. Thank you.
Thank you, Ari. Hello, everybody. My name is Maxime Ladreau, and I am within Schneider Electric, more particularly working for Schneider Digital and acting as an IoT program manager. I'm very glad today to share with you the way how we deployed LoRaWAN networks for Schneider Electric application. But first, a quick step back to see who we are. Schneider Electric, we are present in energy management and automation. We are more precisely focusing on how helping our customer to make their application in a more sustainable way for the future. The application that I will share today is in the low voltage segment of our application, and we are launching in Western Europe, where we have a significant market share of 30%. What are the challenges at Schneider Electric when it comes to connectivity? Many of our assets are very difficult to connect because they are placed in locations like basement or technical cabinet, what we call deep indoor or very deep indoor. They have no access to IT network. They are installed very early in the building phase, even before the IT is installed. They have to be 20 years in the field, so we need to take care of the total cost of ownership of the connectivity. And last challenge, our assets are sold via a chain of intermediaries. So when it comes from connectivity, IoT application, and end-to-end, we need to take care of removing any complexity if we want to succeed. Schneider Electric, we are present in more than 120 countries. We are distributing our products via intermediaries that are from various backgrounds, and they are delivering value from our product to a large panel of customers. All this is possible only if we remove the complexity from the field. That is to say that we need to ensure that we have a unified enrollment process. We need to have seamless integration of the offer, and we need to ensure cybersecurity by design, thus leveraging the secure manufacturing of LoRaWAN. For all these reasons, we needed to have our own Schneider Electric LoRaWAN network. Having our own LoRaWAN network is only possible if we manage the integration of LoRaWAN with EcoStruxure, which is our cloud platform that we are using to deliver the value to our customer. Along this way, we have to take care of end-to-end cybersecurity. We need to ensure that we have unified enrollment process. So we cannot afford to have an enrollment process for France, which is different from Belgium or for Switzerland. So unifying this enrollment process over various geography is among the challenges that we have to take care into when we integrate LoRaWAN in our offer. And we need also to ensure that we have a unified access to public and private network worldwide. For that, we rely on Actility to run our network server and joint server. And on the other hand, we are gathering information via the ThingPark Exchange platform from public network, which we are partnering with. For example, in France, we gather all the data from the Orange public network via the ThingPark Exchange platform. And in some particular case, when we need to place a gateway, this gateway is in a private network architecture and is also gathered in the same network. So we are leveraging the complementary of hybrid architecture between public and private network to ensure a continuity of application for our customer. Let's have a look on the application we are delivering today using LoRaWAN. It's about electrical panel. Electrical panel are the last security step in the electrical distribution. We propose to monitor the safety and the status of this electrical panel. On one hand, with a fire tag, which is monitoring gases exhausted from the panel to prevent fire. On the other hand, we are able to monitor current consumption from each departure line. And all this information is gathered on a mobile platform that helps the facility manager to keep an eye on what is happening in the electrical distribution of his building. All these messages are sent over LoRaWAN using the public operator network in France, Switzerland, and Belgium since 2 years. Of course, we are looking to launch in other geographies. Looking forward to launch in other geographies makes as an evidence that we need an easy global connectivity, roaming, or network collaboration. We can give it the name we want. We need this global connectivity to reach a maturity phase so that we have our more than 120 geographies enabled with LoRaWAN connectivity. This connectivity is gathered to the Schneider Cloud, to the EcoStruxure platform, and that will help our line of business to focus on their product development and on the services and values they want to deliver to our customer. In conclusion, the aggregation of several networks, both public operator from various geographies, but also having the possibility to add private gateways when needed, help us to have a very pervasive LoRaWAN connectivity supporting our application. And thank you for your attention, and I am leaving the floor to Nicolas.
Thanks, Maxime. I'm Nicolas Sornin. I'm one of the founder and shareholder of a company called APIC, operating from Grenoble in the French Alps. APIC develops and commercializes safety solution for mountain outdoor enthusiasts and also professionals working in the mountains. It consists of a very accurate geolocation tracker with some homing system to guide the rescue teams toward the victim if necessary, and some associated services. So because those devices have to very often operate in very remote areas in mountains where there is absolutely no network, no cellular, nothing, APIC also owns and deploy a private LoRaWAN network, which is used to backhaul those geolocation trackers, safety trackers. So it's a 100% standard LoRaWAN network, except deploys very high up in the mountains. In some places, this network covers villages or cities where you have other devices that could benefit from that network coverage. A typical example of that is connected water meters from Veolia birds. So what I'm going to explain in this presentation is how we leverage the private LoRaWAN network deployed by APIC to connect water meters from Veolia in some areas. Okay, first, I'm going to touch base on the specificities of deploying a LoRaWAN network high up in the mountains. A lot of things are unusual there. Coverage is unusual. It's not unusual for us to have antennas that covers up to 100 kilometer line of sight, because gateways tend to be very high up in altitude. They're often deployed in areas hard to reach. Installation is very dependent on weather. We have to face very tough conditions. So the two pictures here at the bottom of the slide are from two different gateways installed on at the top of the Grand Montana station in the Swiss Valley, for example, to give you an idea. Very often, we do not have wired wired backhaul. We have to rely on wireless cellular backhaul. And quite often, we are in areas where cellular signals are not very strong. So we have to take special precautions to maintain a reliable and robust cellular connection, directional antennas, good quality antennas, redundant SIM cards, etc. We face very harsh temperatures in winter, and worse than this, our gateways face a wind and icing, so we can end up with a lot of ice on antennas. So we have to be careful where we actually put them. 5 to 10% of our sites may end up on solar supply because there is no power available where we want to put them. On the right of the slide, you have pictures of gateways that were deployed in the Col du Lautaret in France last summer. Maintenance can be complicated, especially in winter. The gateway might be only reachable, for example, in summer, but in winter, nearly impossible to reach. Another specificity of APIC is that we offer service tracking and safety services for big sports events like trails, for example. And sometimes we deploy a temporary infrastructure simply to cover the event. So gateways might be deployed for a week and then dismantled after that. Now I'm going to go a little bit deeper on what is this roaming agreement and roaming connection between APICs, LoRaWAN network, and Veolia. So if I use exactly the same words than the one used in the backend interface specification of the LoRa Alliance, APIC is the forwarding network. The network server of birds is the home network. So that basically means that the water meters that are transported by our network are provisioned not in our network server, but they are provisioned directly in birds' home network server. So those devices can actually join, the join request is actually broadcasted or routed, sorry, by APIC network to BIRD, and they are provisioned, they actually connect directly to BIRD's LNS. They don't connect to the APIC network. We are simply lending our gateways to BIRD. The network server from BIRD, when the device are joining, give them a device address that's actually starting with BIRD's network ID. So those are really BIRD's devices. They're not APIC devices. They are simply physically, the packets are simply being transported by APIC gateway. This roaming agreement between two private LoRaWAN network, we believe this is a world's first. We think this is the first private network to private network roaming agreement, commercial roaming agreement, actually operational in the world. How does it actually work? It's fairly simple, actually. The bottom right of the screen, you've got a water meter from Veolia BIRD. It's transmitting uplinks. Those uplinks are catched, or may be catched, by one of APIC's gateway in the areas we are covering, in which case our LNS detects that this device address starts with the net ID of BIRD. So this is basically a BIRD's device. We therefore forward those uplinks to the roaming hub operated by Actility in our case. So everything is forwarded encrypted. The actual device packet, which is still encrypted. So we have basically no way to understand or even know what's going on there. Plus some gateway information. Gateway location received the packet, RSSI, on which channel, using which data rate, usual stuff. There is a route configured in the roaming hub such that every device we've a given net ID, so with the BIRD's net ID, gets forwarded to BIRD's LNS, which is also connected to the roaming hub. BIRD's LNS receives that packet, and then that packet is processed exactly like if it had been received by a gateway operated and owned by BIRD. Absolutely no difference. This also means that the interface between the BIRD LNS and all their operational and application backend is absolutely unchanged through this process. They are using their operational application backend without any change, which is one of the main advantages of that solution. Why did we converge on that solution? So when Veolia BIRD first approached APIC to see if there was a possibility to commonalize our infrastructure, one of the requirements was that there should be as little change as possible, and preferably no change, on the application and provisioning interface on BIRD's side. They have been operating this, you know, water meter systems for years and years and years. There have been huge development between their LNS and all their application backend, and they don't want to change it, of course. On our side, we don't want to design a specific connector between our LNS and whatever application backend Bird is using. And actually, we may end up with other commercial agreement like this one, but you know, next time maybe with a parking management or you know, heat metering or public lighting. So we don't want to develop a connector every time. Another one of the main advantage of leveraging passive roaming is we don't have a connector to design. Bird doesn't need to change anything. We are relying on a purely standard backend interface, which has been specified by the LoRa Alliance and which is implemented in the roaming hub. Finally, a very positive point with that solution is that Bird keeps complete ownership and control on the device management, which means they do not need any interaction with us to add a water meter, remove a water meter, perform an inventory, optimize the battery life of their devices. They have full control over the devices. And APIC is only providing physical radio coverage. We do not need to be involved whenever they're doing operation on their devices, which in our case is a huge advantage. Last word now on a business model we converged on. One of the pitfalls of roaming is bin counting, as doing a solution or converging on a solution which is too complex to implement, not on a technical side, because technically it's fairly simple. It can be really messy on the business side. So we ended up with what I think is a very good and very simple solution. APIC and Bird agreed on the following. Bird provided us with the average number of packets that would be transmitted per day by their water meter. They also provided us with a number of devices for every location. So from that, we can infer the average traffic we're going to have to route. If we agree with that, we also have a yearly price per device, completely independent of how many packets actually were sent by the device, completely independent of what data rate was used. Simply, it's just a yearly fee per device. That's it. At the end of the year, we perform a very simple check that both the traffic and the device number, so the number of different device address in a given location, are roughly within the agreed limits, plus or minus 10%. It doesn't need to be precise. So this way, we do not have to monitor traffic. We do not have to do bin counting. We do not have to count packets. We don't have to count devices. Simply once a year, we check that everything is aligned with the contract we've signed. That's it. Very, very simple. So I hope this has been informative to all. Do not hesitate to ask any question at the end of the session. And on behalf of the APIC crew, I'd like to thank you. I'm now going to leave the floor to Mark Phillips from Helium. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Nicolas. Thank you to the Actility team for having me here to talk about Helium and what we're doing with roaming. My name is Mark Phillips. I am the VP of Business Development at Helium. Helium, as I will detail, is a company based in San Francisco, and we're in the process of building what is the largest wireless network in the world at this point, based on a blockchain. And we have some very interesting capabilities with LoRaWAN roaming. So excited to talk about that today. So as I mentioned, we have built the world's largest wireless network based on a blockchain, something called the Helium blockchain. We won't talk too much about the Helium blockchain here today. We're going to focus more on the Helium network and its the LoRa component, which is the largest piece of the network, and specifically how we enable roaming with partners like Actility. So let's take a look at Helium. So Helium is built on something called a hotspot. So hotspots look closest to traditional LoRaWAN gateways. They provide long-range IoT coverage, specifically using LoRa and LoRaWAN. There's also a version of a hotspot that does 5G coverage, but we're not going to talk too much about that today. And so the big innovation for Helium and the way that we've built LoRaWAN coverage is using something called HNT. HNT is a token on the Helium blockchain. And although Helium has been building wireless networks for about 8 years, About 3 years ago, we decided that there was probably an easier way to build wireless networks than your traditional capital heavy deployments. And so we came up with this system for incentivizing what we call operators or hosts to deploy Helium enabled wireless coverage. And so on the right, you see, I think, six different versions of hotspots. At this point, as I'll talk about, there's about 30 different versions of hotspots. But the easiest way to think about this is a LoRaWAN gateway that basically rewards the operator in HNT, in this native token, for providing coverage. And so here we have a few examples of some very well and nicely deployed hotspots. I believe all of these are in Portugal. And so I don't know the exact vendors of these specific hotspots, but the point I'm trying to get across here is that people in the Helium community, and we number in the millions now, take a lot of time and effort and care to deploy very good, very robust wireless coverage. And if you use the Helium network, and at this point we have thousands of companies and tens of thousands of developers that are operating on the network, you'll find that where there is coverage, it's very good LoRaWAN coverage, suitable for production applications. And where there's not coverage, there tends to be coverage not too long after, because the network does a very good job of filling in the gaps of coverage because of the incentive mechanism. So let's take a look at some of the statistics on the Helium network. At this point, we have about 370,000 Helium hotspots deployed as of today. Our estimates, which quite frankly might be a bit conservative, are that there's going to be over 450,000 hotspots on the Helium network providing LoRaWAN coverage by the end of this year, 2021. An even more staggering statistic is that the community at this point adds about 3,500 Helium hotspots a day to the network, which is expanding LoRa coverage at a wild rate. Another thing to focus on is the idea of data credits. So in Helium network, when you have a sensor that's sending data, this could be a soil moisture probe, this could be a package tracker, this could be a mouse trap, these send LoRa packets as part of their application. Every time a packet is sent across the network, an uplink, a downlink, you're paying the network in something called a data credit. So the Helium network doesn't have a traditional sort of billing or pricing model that looks like dollars or, you know, per month per sensor or any onboarding fee. You purely pay data credits per sensor per LoRaWAN packet. Specifically, one data credit gets you 24 bytes worth of LoRaWAN payload. And so over the last 30 days, there's been about $4.3 million worth of data credits spent, and that rate is accelerating month on month at a very impressive rate. We're in about 152 countries with Helium network coverage. That's up from about 140 in the last month. And there's about 29,000 cities. There's more than 29,000 cities with Helium network coverage at this point. And again, that number is growing at a very fast pace month on month. One of the most unique things about the Helium network is how it's built and who operates it. So we call it the people's network, and it very much is that. And so, you know, we have, as I mentioned, about 370,000 LoRaWAN gateways deployed on the network now. Those are operated by over 145,000 individual people and companies. So it's a very much a community, people-driven network. And a lot of these companies are deploying actual sensor applications on the network, and I'll talk about a few of those examples in a moment. But a lot of these people are purely meant to provide coverage for these companies that are deploying sensors at scale on the network. And that's a pretty interesting thing that we have on Helium. Our community is very large. So we use Discord for the primary sort of mechanism for developing code and discussing everything from sensor optimization to HNT token economics and large sort of network changes. At this point, we have 120,000 active members in Discord. I've got a link to our Discord at the end of this presentation. I would recommend people join if you're not in there. It really is the best way to get fully integrated with the Helium network and the Helium community. We also seem to be incredibly popular on TikTok for some reason. And, you know, we have over a million daily views of videos that are being created by people that are operating hotspots and deploying sensors on the network. And we get a lot of adoption through channels like TikTok. And then lastly, on the network, we have a system for any company to build an approved hotspot. We call them makers on the Helium network. And so there's a process that the community has laid out that's called HIP-19, where you can apply to become a manufacturer, build a hotspot that's compliant with the Helium network, and then distribute, sell, support it. At this point, we have about 25 approved hotspot manufacturers And there's another 40, I think it actually might be 45, that are in the queue waiting to be approved. So that the supply of coverage is not slowing down, and there's lots of companies coming into the ecosystem to sort of meet the need of what the network is putting out there. And this is a, I think it's a bit of an outdated graph at this point, but this sort of shows the growth of the raw coverage. The network was launched in August of 2019 in a city called Austin, Texas, with about 150 Helium hotspots. And since then, there has been an explosion of coverage. There's a bit of an inflection point sometime around March of 2021. And as I mentioned, this is a bit outdated. This only takes us through 240,000 hotspots. This growth curve has continued to accelerate. I don't think I could actually fit the actual chart on a slide at this point. And so this is an example of some Helium coverage in Zurich. There are, and I think this number again is probably outdated, but there's at least 300 hotspots online in just Zurich. And so this is a picture from a tool called Helium Explorer, the URL, and I'll have a link to this at the end, is explorer.helium.com. And so each one of these shapes, each one of these hexagons represents some amount of Helium coverage. There are, you know, some hexagons with five hotspots, some hexagons with one hotspot, but hopefully this gives a sense of the sort of coverage that we're bringing to a city like Zurich. There are thousands of cities across the world that have this caliber of Helium coverage. And so any sensor deployed in or around Zurich is likely to be able to connect very easily to the core Helium network. And so, you know, we're building this massive coverage network, but ultimately, you know, all we really care about is usage on the network. The network being very large and, you know, being in 152 countries and then 29,000 cities is very interesting. But none of this really matters unless we can, you know, get a lot of usage, a ton of sensors on the core Helium network. And so, you know, at this point, there's thousands of companies and tens of thousands of developers that are deploying sensing applications on top of the network. A few of the recent examples that are interesting to highlight are companies like Erica and Airly, which are both out of Europe and are both building very interesting air quality monitoring technology. Victor, in the bottom left here, is a company based in the United States that builds one of my favorite applications, which is a LoRa-connected mouse and rat trap. And they have large deployments in the US and also in Europe. And you can go to helium.com and see a ton of other examples and use cases and videos about all the customers and users that are actually using the Helium network. And so that is a brief overview of Helium. I've got a bunch of information here about how to get in touch with me. I did want to spend a few seconds actually focusing on roaming before we jump into the Q&A. So let me jump over here. And so, you know, as we've built out the Helium network and sort of have built this sort of staggering amount of LoRaWAN coverage, what we've come to realize is that we can be very valuable to organizations like Actility, who are actively building out, you know, enterprise IoT use cases on LoRaWAN, and who might want to expand their coverage virtually overnight by taking advantage of the Helium network in what looks like a relatively straightforward roaming arrangement. And so you know, recently we started working with Alper and the team at Actility about what it might look like to have roaming enabled between Helium and Actility. And that was a very enjoyable process working with Alper and the team to sort of hook up that integration. The way that Helium does roaming looks most like passive roaming in the sort of LoRa Alliance roaming sense. And we make it very easy, and this is enabled by the Helium blockchain, to basically purchase packets of a specific net ID that might be of interest to a core network. And so you know, Actility is one of the first roaming partners that we have on the Helium network. We're very excited about the relationship. And you'll see a lot more from Helium in the way of roaming over the next, you know, 6 to 12 months. We think it's one of the biggest differentiators for us. And so with that, I am going to leave it to Claire to pick it up after me. And I look forward to the Q&A.
Thank you, Mark. We'll be next. My name is Claire Miona. I'm a product marketing manager at Kinéis, and I'm in charge of offers and services, as well as partnerships and also platform integration. So Kinéis covers every single place on Earth. Kinéis is a satellite operator and a global connectivity provider. As a satellite operator, Kinéis offers connectivity and other services with an existing constellation of satellites, the Argos system, and benefits from 40 plus years of expertise from CNES, so it's the French Space Agency, and CLS. In 2023, we will launch a new constellation of 25 nanosatellites with the support of a 20 ground network station to extend our offer to commercial and industrial applications. As a global connectivity provider, Kinéis offers a unique combination of low-cost and low-power technologies tailored for IoT. We are a provider of connectivity services as well as native positioning. With a global coverage, meaning that devices can send data with Kinéis anywhere on the planet, operated 24/7, we are enabling customers to get visibility over their assets worldwide and accelerate their digital transformation. And as you can see here on the slide, you have an example of the constellation in action here. In terms of applications, we are already active on the science and environment and NGO verticals, supported mainly with the Argos service. We are also addressing maritime, smart agriculture, network and infrastructures, and also transport and logistics verticals. A typical use case for Kinéis would be to trace and monitor the integrity of an asset when the said asset is moving anywhere on the planet or in remote areas where no terrestrial coverage is available. For example, we currently have a project with cattle tracking with an ear tag in Australia. We are also building an ecosystem of partners and integrators to provide Kinéis-enabled solutions to customers. With Kinéis, we have a whole range of applications addressed for IoT, as Kinéis provides a truly global satellite coverage to cover any single place on Earth. If we are looking a little bit into details about the Kinéis data distribution architecture, so first of all, devices are sending messages, so directly to satellites with a Kinéis module or a Kinéis chipset. The satellite is picking up the messages and then sending the data to the nearest ground station available. Then we are transmitting the data from the ground station to the processing and distribution center. And there we have what we call the Kinéis service center that is capable of distributing the data through connectors as well as displaying the data on the platform, and then we can transmit the data to any platforms, third-party application, business applications, and final users. In March 2021, we announced the integration with Actility through ThinkParks Exchange, and customers can now receive IoT data seamlessly aggregated from either Kinéis or any LoRaWAN operator through ThinkPark Actility IoT platform. If we take a look and a deep dive on the integration with Actility ThinkPark solution, so first of all, we have Kinéis ready devices communicating data through the Kinéis network and system. Then the Kinéis service center is providing device management, user management, and all sorts of data access and monitoring to a customer, but it's also capable through protocol connectors to distribute the data to ThinkPark RAN connector, then ThinkPark Exchange, so through Actility platform. And then LoRaWAN operators can connect their data and also have the Kinéis data through Actility platform and then redirect the information to customer platforms, business application, final user, anything related to customer integration. So this way, by getting integrated with the ThinkPark Exchange ecosystem, Kinéis makes the satellite network coverage available to any terrestrial LoRaWAN network provider, public or private, since we are integrated seamlessly to Actility platform and solution. This means that we can have hybrid solutions, meaning that devices can be fitted with Kinéis connectivity and also with LoRaWAN connectivity, and emit the data and transmit the data seamlessly through Kinéis and Actility integration. And if we can take a look at a use case example or illustration, we can have in an industrial environment, we can have a private LoRaWAN network deployed in a warehouse or in an industrial site, for example, with a device that is hybrid, so capable of switching from LoRaWAN connectivity to Kinéis connectivity when needed. And the device can use LoRaWAN connectivity, so the private one, to transmit information or data within the warehouse or within the industrial environment. And when so the asset is leaving the coverage bound of the private LoRaWAN network, then we can switch to Kinéis to ensure that the data is continuously transmitted and that the asset is traced and monitored when leaving the bound of LoRaWAN private network. And we can see here that with Kinéis, you can track and trace your assets through transport and delivery anywhere on the planet. With the ThinkPark Exchange integration, Actility and Kinéis can provide a ready-to-use solution to manage any hybrid connectivity use case and bring an answer to any of the use cases where continuity of connectivity is needed. And thank you. That's all I have to present. And I'm leaving the floor to Albert now.
Thank you. Thank you, Claire. And I'd like to thank every one of our speakers for sharing very precious insight about their business and how they leverage roaming. So let's see. Okay, we've been already getting a lot of questions. Please continue putting your questions in the Q&A box. All right, so looking at the questions. Okay, so here's the first one I'd like to relay. The question, I think this would be best answered by Ari from Digita. Are there roaming charges associated with LoRa roaming?
I believe there will be. The commercial side of the roaming between LoRaWAN operators is still a bit open, but I would estimate that there will be certain extra charge for roaming, but also I believe that will be fairly small versus the kind of what is the regular charge or fee for LoRaWAN traffic, but not exact numbers to give at the moment.
Thank you, Ari. Okay, the next question is for Maxim. The question is, for Schneider, even if you have your own LoRaWAN network, would it be still possible to use Schneider devices from any other private LoRaWAN network, or they are locked to Schneider network only? Okay. All right, so this one, let me forward this question to Nicola. Nicola, the question is, does Epic have presence in the USA?
Okay. So to answer your question, no, we do not have yet footprint in the US. We are planning to introduce our products and therefore the associated network coverage in the US in 2023.
All right. And while we have you on the microphone, another question is for you, Nicola. Will Epic be connecting other devices than the birds ones on its network?
So we're already doing that. So I specifically talked about the birds thing because there has been press release on that, and it's a commercial contract. We do also connect devices, some devices mainly for academic research for free. We've been connecting a lot of environmental sensors already with the University of Grenoble, some traps for detectors in traps for wild animals to do animal counting, thing like this. And very, very probably we're gonna deploy, or we're gonna be connecting devices for basically smart city devices, parking, heating, water, electricity, because villages and ski resorts are no different from any other city. They are digitizing at the moment, and they need some sensors, and they need to connect those sensors. So we can see a lot of traction on that area.
Thank you, Nicolas. Okay, and the next question is for Claire Kinéis. Is the service commercially available, and in what regions or countries can we use it? Shall I read the question again?
No, that's fine. As long as you can hear,
yes, yes, perfect. Very well, Claire.
So coverage is global. It is currently global since we have a constellation that is providing service, that is the Argo system. And it will be, completed with another constellation in 2023. And the coverage will still be global. What is changing is the latency or the revisit time between two satellite passes, meaning that the device will see more satellites passing on its head.
Thank you, Claire. Okay. And the next question is for Mark. Mark, what about the Helium blockchain makes it easy to enable roaming with partner networks like Actility?
Yeah, thank you, Albert. So what's pretty novel about the Helium network is this blockchain mechanism. And so what that enables is for very straightforward sort of purchase to be made from one LNS with it, as I mentioned in the presentation, with a given net ID blessed by the LoRa Alliance. So with the Actility roaming integration, for example, and I'm forgetting what your exact net ID is, Albert, but Helium operates what amounts to a roaming specific server. We call it the packet purchaser, which acts on behalf of a target net ID and then just delivers packets for that net ID to an endpoint that looks like a pretty straightforward API integration. And so, From that perspective, it's very straightforward to wire up what looks closest to passive roaming in the sort of traditional LoRaWAN sense. And so the operator of the target network, whether it's Actility or someone like Senate or pretty much any LoRaWAN network, purchases packets for a fixed cost. These are what we call data credits. I talked about these in the presentation. And so data credits are priced at a known fixed US dollar amount. So you can buy 100,000 LoRaWAN packets for one US dollar. That price is never going to change. It won't go up, it won't go down. And so as an operator, you always have predictability when wanting to purchase packets from a network. And so you can easily add hundreds of thousands of LoRaWAN gateways to your network coverage virtually overnight for a fee that's never going to change, and you can build into a business model quite nicely.
Thank you, Mark. Maxime, if you are back on with the audio, let me know, and then I will direct the next question to you again. Are you
hello here? Albert, hello everyone, can you hear me now?
Yes, it works again. Great, thank you, Maxime. So the question to you and Schneider is, for Schneider, even if you have your own LoRaWAN network, would it be possible to use Schneider devices from any other private LoRaWAN network, or are they locked to the Schneider network only?
So, basically, when it comes to the LoRaWAN product, we are supporting different business models. If you are buying standalone products, you can use a Schneider Electric product in any network you want, because you will be able to commission it via the app key. When we go for solution business, we are using the best installation experience, the best easiness of installation, relying on Secure Element and Secure Manufacturing, which helps us to automate everything. And thus, we are bind from the sensor to the solution because we are offering a solution. And on the last, way to do business, of course, we are happy to open our LoRaWAN solution to third parties, which are enriching the ecosystem of sensors and devices that are connected to the Schneider LoRaWAN solution.
Great. Maxim, let me also channel the next question for you. Does Schneider intend to open the network to other usage than the Schneider Electric's one? Any plans to sell connectivity?
Definitely, we are not in the business of connectivity. We are not a telco company. We do not intend to do it, even for LoRaWAN. Regarding connectivity, we are customers. We are buying connectivity from the ecosystem, from the various operators that can leverage geographies, coverage via passive roaming to our platform. And only for the sake of optimization, we are deploying some gateway for some specific application.
All right. Let's see. Okay. Here's a question for Ari, Digita. What other public networks does Digita have roaming partnership?
We currently have a roaming set up and ongoing with the four other European operators. And looking forward to extend that figure, hopefully quickly. Currently, we operate with our friends in Netherlands, in Switzerland, in Sweden and Norway. But like I said, looking to extend that, hopefully quite fast, to other countries.
Thank you, Ari. Okay, and the next question. So Mark, can you talk a bit more about how purchasing packets from Helium Network actually works for a roaming partner?
I'm sorry, Albert, I missed the first part of that question. Can you repeat it, please?
Sure. So can you talk a bit more about how purchasing packets from Helium Network actually works for a roaming partner?
Yeah, so as I mentioned before, the Helium blockchain has a system called data credits. And so data credits are based on the native token of the Helium blockchain, which is HNT. And HNT produces data credits. You can always purchase data credits for US dollars. And so whether you're an end user like Erica or Airly or Victor, putting your own sensors on the network, or you're a roaming partner like Actility, the method works exactly the same. For every LoRaWAN packet that you want to purchase, be it from a device or from the Helium network itself, and specifically a packet covers 24 bytes of LoRaWAN payload, you spend one data credit to acquire that packet. And then that packet is recorded on the blockchain as having been purchased by you. And the hotspot that actually operated, or rather routed that packet from the network to your either LNS or your API to ingest it, is actually credited with they earn the HNT reward for routing that packet. And so in the roaming world for us, we operate roaming routers for people with whom we've done roaming integrations, and packets are purchased whenever they need to be, or rather data credits are purchased. And then those are used for packets whenever the sort of roaming operator needs to sort of fill their data credit balance. And that happens via a user interface for roaming specifically.
All right. So the next question, I think something that I can answer. The question is, passive roaming is better supported in LoRaWAN specification version 1.1.x. So please shed some light on the release on version 1.1.1. Well, actually, the passive roaming is fully transparent to the end device. So it already works for the end devices implementing LoRaWAN version 1.0, 1.0.1, 102, 103, and 104. And that's what's implemented and deployed in the field. Now, what comes new with the LoRaWAN version 1.1 is the so-called handover roaming. And the handover roaming is not available, implemented in the market. So far, the passive roaming has been successfully meeting the needs of the market, and that's where all of the current R&D investments went into across the whole ecosystem. And the handover roaming is about moving the anchor point from one network to the other, whereas with the passive roaming, the whole LoRaWAN session stays anchored at the home network, which appears to be an essential element of maintaining the control. In a way, related to what Nicolas Onan had mentioned, birds maintaining full control of its devices, even when they are roaming into the EPIC network at the top of the mountains. So this is like a question slash comment. All the presentations were good. However, unfortunately, I didn't get how can we connect end device via roaming method. So I can take this and then maybe folks can add as well. Now, if you are an end user and if you want your devices to roam around, you should be using a network that provides roaming. And through the roaming service provided by your home network, now your devices can enjoy the coverage provided by multiple networks. So that's what, for example, Digita with the roaming agreements they have, or the Helium with the roaming they have, they can provide this type of coverage extension. And alternatively, because LoRaWAN core network infrastructure is pretty low cost and it can be operated by anyone, you could also be building your own core network. In a way, that's what Schneider does, as Maxim has explained. And once you have your own core network, then you can start going around and setting up roaming agreements with the other public and private networks. So as a solution maker or an end user, as an enterprise, depending on what role you have these various types of options in your hand. Or if you're a network provider, obviously you can use a network capable core network and start setting up agreements with various players. A lot of them are already in this call. You can get in touch with them. All right, let me see, going up. So this one is again for Ari. Any plans to complement coverage with satellite networks, Ari?
Thanks, Alper. That's certainly a very interesting question. There are a handful of kind of very remote use cases where even with the kind of significant coverage, there's still kind of black spots, so to say. And I think satellite LoRaWAN would nicely complement that. So again, can't say about the time frame, but certainly I'm interested to look at that. If it's feasible to implement. Well, yes, in the future, definitely.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Ari. And another question with a similar angle, Maxim. Any thoughts about leveraging community networks like Helium?
Basically, today, our business model is via distribution channel. So we need to know pre-existing coverage before launching an offer. And actors in the ecosystem, which are, I would say, dealing with nationwide network, are more the telco company. But on the other hand, we see more and more community network gathering this nationwide capability of coverage. So we are keeping it on the ecosystem, and that could be a possibility today to leverage enhanced coverage or another way of getting coverage for some countries.
Thank you, Maxim. And an epic question for Nicola. Let me see. The question is about where do you have epic coverage in Finland? I think it was Sweden first, but then corrected as Finland.
I'm guessing this was a mistake and the question wasn't directed to EPIC.
Okay.
So just to answer it, so for the moment, EPIC does not operate network in Finland or Sweden. For the moment, we operate network in southern part of Swiss, the French Alps, and the northern part of Italian Alps.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. And another question to you, Nicola. Have you looked at using LoRaWAN gateways in drones, like flyby reading?
We are using drones. So very good question, Alper. We are using drones, but we found that it was very impractical to actually fly a gateway. Too heavy, too cumbersome, a bit too complex. What we are doing is when we fly a very simplified single channel, single data rate gateway, if you may, based on a device radio, that simply stores locally on the drone everything it receives, and we analyze the data when the drone lands. So this wouldn't be suitable to collect normal LoRaWAN data. It's only suitable to actually detect or localize one of our tracker in an emergency situation.
Thank you, Nicola. Okay, so question is, I did not understand if Epic is using ThinkPark Exchange or another proprietary one. Well, in this presentation, Nicola explained Epic is using ThinkPark Exchange to interconnect with birds, so.
Correct.
Right, okay. Okay, and another, well then, another question for Mark. Mark, for Helium, what's on the roadmap? What are the projections for Helium network coverage growth over the next 6 to 12 months?
Yeah, thank you, Albert. So in terms of coverage projections, they're quite rosy, I would say. We've been told by gateway manufacturers in the ecosystem that there's somewhere around 1.5 million chipsets on order to sort of fulfill what they see as a demand to create coverage. So you know, we're looking at 3 to maybe 4x the amount of coverage that we already have in the next 12 months, which is quite exciting, especially for companies using the network and the potential roaming partners. When it comes to roaming specifically, so we're at this point, how we deliver roaming from the Helium network is fairly analogous to a fire hose, meaning you do a roaming integration and then we just send you all the packets of a given net ID. While that's very useful, integrating, you know, data from hundreds of thousands of LoRaWAN gateways into your network infrastructure can be a little bit noisy. So we're doing a lot of work to enable roaming partners to basically get a more fine-grained look at the data coming out of the infrastructure, whether that's, you know, only from a subset of hotspots or from a certain geography, and sort of being able to you know, slice and dice, I guess, packets from a given net ID and things under that sort of idea. So those are probably the two biggest things on the roadmap from coverage and from a roaming perspective.
Okay, so there it was a question for me. Question is Roaming Hub supporting delayed message delivery when gateway backhaul is down? This is an awesome feature of the iStation CPF. Well, actually, the Roaming Hub operates statelessly. It operates on a message basis. As such, it's able to support flows in any pattern. So whether there's continuous flow of roaming traffic or whether they come in spikes, the platform is scalable to address both types of traffic. So I suspect this question was asked in the context of supporting satellite networks. All right, let me see, doing a quick look to see if I'm not missing any questions, because there are some not roaming related questions embedded. I'm trying to weed through them. Receiving multiple uplink frames and how the standard LoRaWAN backend interface deals with that. So, As I was saying, the macro diversity is a great feature of LoRaWAN, which enhances the network resiliency by combining multiple radio networks at the same time. A side effect of that is the same uplink frame can get delivered to the home network by multiple partners. And in case the partners are paid on a per frame basis, this can potentially create extra charges to the home network. Now, this issue has been flagged, obviously, and it is under discussion both in the technical committee and also among the partners. Now, there are multiple technical approaches to that, but none of them seem trivial to jump on them. And we believe the solution would be a mix of a technical approach and a business approach as well. As you might already be aware, the LoRaWAN connectivity pricing is still evolving. And in order to maintain the highly scalable and the low-cost structure of LoRaWAN, we are seeking to find a sweet spot of a solution that will be supported by both a technical approach and also a business approach, in the sense how the traffic is charged and priced for roaming and non-roaming. So I would say it's work in progress. This issue has been flagged, but so far it has not been a showstopper, because the kind of overlap we've been facing are like two public networks having overlap at the border region, or a private and a public network having overlap, but the private network having a small footprint. So the amount of overlap that is causing extra charges are so small, to the point that usually a small percentage of error in the accounting is usually accommodated by roaming partners. So it falls under that margin at the moment. Are there any final remarks our speakers would like to share before we close the session?
No, thanks, Alper.
Thanks a lot. It was nice to be able to present here, and thanks for all the participants.
Thanks. Yes.
Thank you, everyone, for the possibility of sharing what we are doing in LoRaWAN.
Yep. Thank you for having us, Alper.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I would like to thank Claire, Nicola, Maxim, Ari, and Mark for this very informative presentation and the discussion engagement. So we have talked about a lot of first things in here, things that are done for the very first time in the industry. And I really appreciate the speakers being very sincere and being very open in freely sharing all the insight and all the experience they have. So thanks again, and I'd like to thank the audience as well for their valuable questions. With that, I wish everyone a good day and hope to meet at the next webinar. Thank you.